Hello, everybody. My name's Steve Hutton. I'm the CEO of True Potential Wealth Management, and welcome to podcast number 213. I'm joined by an esteemed panel today. First of all, I ought to let you know this is all about our tax year end and using your allowances. So we're going to dispense with any investment chat today, but we're going to actually talk all things that you can and can't do with your allowances before the tax year end. I'm joined at my far end there by Luke Bolton-Johnson, a qualified advisor. Hayley Mack in the middle. Welcome, Hayley. Hayley manages several of our teams in our client service department. And John Mason, another qualified advisor, but unfortunately at the minute he's working in compliance. But today he's here with us to help us on how to use our tax allowances. Enough, and let's get straight into and talk turkey. Yeah, well, hang on. This has been recorded before Easter, and I do realise that we don't eat turkey at Easter, so it's not some kind of stupid error. There's a hierarchy of tax year-end benefits in my mind, but I think we're not going to deal with them in any particular order. But let's start off with a reasonably easy one to understand. Let's talk about ISAs. You'll all probably be aware of ISAs. You may be using them already. You may have different types. But I think before we get going, it's probably easier if we explain the different types of ISAs that are available on the market. I'll start off with you, Luke. Do you want to just outline which type of ISAs are available in the market and how they sort of play out?
Yeah, of course, Steve. Thanks for that. So there's four main ISAs available on the market. You've got your cash ISAs, which a lot of people might have been attracted to over the last couple of years. You could probably get maybe 3%, 4% in a cash ISA. The way that works is really straightforward. You put it in ISA, it's in cash. Any gains of an ISA we know are tax-free, so you can get that nice 2%, 3%, 4%. On a cash ISA, you probably see the interest rates on cash ISA start to come down now. As interest rates come down, in fact, that's what we're already seeing in the market. You've then got what we offer at True Potential, which is a stocks and shares ISA. So those can invest in funds. For example, you can invest in our balanced fund within there. You could transfer in a pension, so you have a large cash ISA. Maybe you're not getting the interest rate that you want anymore, and you can transfer into our funds, into stocks and shares. So that's the stocks and shares ISA you've got there as well. You've got innovative finance ISAs. They're a bit different. They involve borrowing to individuals and companies, so maybe a little bit more risky there. So they're obviously quite different in the way that they work. You've then got the LISA, which is the last kind of ISA, the lifetime ISA. Mm-hmm. That can be used. It can invest in cash and shares again. But you've also got some rules on withdrawals. You need to be careful about taking money out because it's linked to a bonus, a 25% bonus that you can use for either your first home up to a value of $450,000 or retirement. So you've got a few more rules in there with the LISA as well. And those are the four main types of ISAs that are on offer.
Okay, that's interesting because I alluded to the fact that this was the most simple tax-efficient product, and it now doesn't sound so simple. The interesting thing for me there, Luke, was we talk about cash ISAs, which we all know are really popular in the market. My contention is that they're popular because people default into them. Their bank probably rings them up and tries to sell them a cash ISA. And we talk about where interest rates are at the minute, but they're generally trending down. I think even the MPC said at the last meeting that the next move will probably be down. So I'm sort of keen to get across the message to our clients that investing for an interest rate today, it's often not fixed in that kind of ISA, or is it? Have I got that wrong?
No, you're right, Steve. You can get fixed products. Normally, you'll get them for 1 or 2 years within an ISA, but ultimately, you're at the mercy of interest rates. If we look at what Andrew Bailey, the head of the Bank of England, said was they expect them to come down by 2025. And what we've seen happen in the market over the last 3 to 6 months is interest rates coming down as an expectation, and you saw a reversal of fortunes in the markets really strong from November through to now in the US and the FTSE, etc. So, you know, you might be able to get maybe short-term 3-4%, might be fine for an emergency fund or some money that you got stored away that you might need access to in the next 5 years. But if you think more long-term, you know, you could get that in 1 month in something like an aggressive portfolio. That's what we've seen over the last 3 months. So, yeah, quite a big difference there.
Again, and I suppose this is where I'll bring you into the conversation, John. Looking at sort of interest rates at 3 and 4 and trending down, you've got to take into account of inflation when you're looking at that. Because even though it's a tax shelter, an ISA, it doesn't shelter you from inflation.
Absolutely. I think, you know, we've talked about rates of 3, 4, even 5% at times over the last couple of years. And I think when you're putting your money into a cash ISA, it feels very safe because you know exactly the interest rate you're going to get. A lot of people take value from that level of security. Now, as you've mentioned, when you've got inflation in the background, yes, you've put your money into a cash ISA. Yes, you're getting a return of 3 or 4% each year, but at times inflation's been running at 9%. So that money you've put into the ISA, yes, it's growing in pure value terms, but everything costs much more. So you've lost money in real terms. That ISA, or the money you've put in it, it doesn't quite buy you as much as it did when you first put the money into the ISA. So when we talk about cash ISAs, as Luke's mentioned, sometimes perfectly reasonable to keep your emergency funds in there. But if you are looking for your money to grow in real terms, above and beyond inflation, we tend to find that a stocks and shares ISA has the potential to do that. With the caveat that, yes, from day to day, your funds might move up or down in value.
Okay, that's interesting, because then we're saying then don't let the tax advantage wag the investment or the interest rate dog, as it were. Hayley, interesting though that we talk about cash ISAs. Are we getting many clients ringing up, taking money out of our products and putting them into cash ISAs, or is that not something we suffer from?
Not necessarily, you know. It's been a little bit turbulent over the last, say, 12 months, but I would say the last kind of 3-4 months, there's not really been many requests for that. The kind of main question that we're asking, getting asked at the moment, is how to put money in to utilise allowances.
Yeah. That's good, because I would hate, looking down from my aged perch, to think that people are actually taking money and putting it into cash when things are dropping, as we just talked about. So
yeah,
interesting. One thing I think, there's a thing called a junior ISA. Yeah. Being a grandparent now, I'm looking to make because I'm from Yorkshire, a very small investment for my grandson. But could I do that via a regular ISA or a junior ISA?
Yeah, so if you're looking towards grandchildren or children or whoever it might be, the junior ISA is there to allow you to put money away in your child or your grandchild's name. It's tax sheltered in much the same way that a regular ISA is, but your child, as it were, has their own separate ISA allowance. So I myself want to invest in my own name. I've got my £20,000 ISA allowance. If I've got a child, then they have their own separate junior ISA allowance, which is set at £9,000 each tax year. So if I'm in a position to put some money away for my child or my grandchild, yes, a junior ISA allows me to save or invest in their name, and then that money has the potential to grow until they reach the age of 18, at which point they're allowed to take the money out.
Right, so they can't access their ISA until they're 18?
Correct. If you put the money into a junior ISA, once they reach 16, they can start to make investment decisions if it's in a stocks and shares ISA, but they can't access that money. It is very much tied up until they reach the age of 18.
And that's a different concept to a regular ISA, isn't it, Luke? I think with a regular ISA, you can take money in and out as you feel the need, hopefully you won't, but you can...
Correct, you've obviously got, everyone has a 20,000 ISA limit each tax year. Our ISAs are actually fully flexible, so if you have a large ISA, whatever you take out, you can put back in the same tax year as well, so really flexible product. Obviously, all the drawdown is all tax-free as well, so that's a really important point to note on there, with the limits.
Okay, so then... Before we move on from ISAs, and I'll come to you in a minute, Hayley, because I think it's important we tell people how they can invest in ISAs. But what are the tax advantages of an ISA then? What, you know, is it, do I get tax relief on my money going in? How does it work?
Yeah, so we've talked about cash ISAs, how they pay an amount of interest. And what happens when you put your money in an ISA is that interest is completely tax-free. So however much you've got in your ISA, if it is a cash ISA, then you don't have to worry about paying tax on that interest that you're generating. Now, when it comes to a stocks and shares ISA, the idea is that you place money into the ISA, it will hopefully grow in value over time, and you'll then be able to reap the benefit of that in the future. Now, if you invest money outside of an ISA and that money grows, when you eventually come to take that money back out or sell those investments, you can often be subject to capital gains tax. It's the tax on the amount that the money's grown by. Mm-hmm. One of the great things about the ISA is when you invest money, if it grows in value and then you sell that investment in the future, you're not required to pay capital gains tax at all, because it's got that tax shelter around it. The same is true with dividends. So again, if you're making an investment into a stocks and shares ISA and it generates dividends for you, because you've got that ISA wrapped around your investment account, you're not going to pay tax on those dividends, which is a great benefit.
So it is exactly that then, it's a tax shelter. I paid out of my net income, but once it's in there, it's sheltered from all the taxes, and I can take it out tax-free as well, all of it if I wish. And if I want to put some more back in, I can put it back in. Right, that sounds really flexible. Really importantly then, Hayley, let's it's always important when we talk to you, but really importantly, how do I go about investing in my ISA through True Potential?
So the easiest way to do that is through Impulse Save. Impulse Save is quite a simple technology. It works as basically what a bank transfer or like a bank payment would work. So the way in which I speak to it with regards to clients is if you are buying something online, you put in your card details and the money gets taken straight from the bank and paid to that particular product that you're buying. Impulse Save works exactly the same. So you can log in through your app or your client site. You click into the particular policy that you want to invest into, ISA in this instance. You put in your bank details, so your card details. Select the amount. You can either utilise your full allowance or remain an allowance, or select a specific amount that you want to put in. You will go through, process the payment, and that then gets invested into whichever policy you've chosen. The good thing with impulse savers, you can actually invest up until 11:59 on the tax year end deadline, which is, it's really flexible for clients to be able to do that. From that point, you can save your card details so you don't have to put them in again. You can set up reminders on impulse save, so it can kind of give you a nudge every month or every 3 months if you want to remind you to do that, utilize your allowances throughout the year rather than waiting until the end. But it's a really straightforward process for people, and also the team are available if you've never used it before and just want a little bit of help with that to be able to walk you through.
All right, that's excellent. You're a step ahead of me, Hayley, as usual, because I may not appear, but I've written some questions down here that I keep consulting. But one of them was, what is the cutoff time? You want to repeat it again?
It is, yeah.
What's the last time I can invest into my ISA?
11:59 p.m. on the 5th of April.
Brilliant, thank you very much. I should also say at this stage that if you find investing in any of the topics we're going to talk about today a bit confusing, you can get in touch with us and talk to one of our eloquent advisors, and we will not charge you for that. So please give us a ring if you've got, or contact us through email or your client site if you want to talk about any of the things we're going to talk about and have already talked about. So great, ISAs are a great shelter. You can do them for your grandchildren in their names, and they can't get their hands on it till they're 18, which is equally as important. But equally then, you can do an impulse save now. Yeah, and we must remember that you can benefit from our rewards scheme if you use our impulse save.
You can.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about that, Hayley?
Yeah, so the rewards, if you have activated it through your client site, it's a really good pop-up. You can do it through Google, that whichever thing you're searching, it will tell you whichever item you can get cash back on what particular sites. The percentages in rewards are different. So say, for example, if you're buying something off B&Q, it might have a high percentage on Screwfix, which if you get the addition through Google Chrome, it will actually tell you that. The reward can be paid either directly into your investments, or it can be cashed out. With the reward, though, you're already spending the money. So you've already spent the £50 or whatever it might be. And it's just money, kind of additional money going straight into your investment. Okay. So
it is effectively cash back on your investment.
It's cash back on your investment, yeah.
Okay, very important point. And sometimes I forget to mention it, but not today. Yeah. Okay, ISAs, you know, really useful. We should all be thinking about them. Now, the next topic is one very close to my heart. Don't be rude if you're wondering why. It's probably quite obvious. And it's pensions. Let's talk a little bit about pensions. Because for me, when we talk about an ISA, you're going into a tax shelter with money that's already being taxed, it's subtly different with pensions, isn't it, John?
Yeah, absolutely. What you've said is right. Is I've been paid money from the work that I do. I've been taxed on it through my payslip. I could put that money into an ISA. It can grow tax-free. I can take it back out. But as you say, I've already been taxed on that income. Now, pensions work slightly differently in that they've got an immediate advantage to placing money into them. So if I have a pension and I want to make a contribution to that pension from my own pocket, yes, I might have already been taxed on that money. But what the government do is they say, well, to almost reward you for putting money into the pension and saving for your retirement, what we'll do is we'll give you your tax back. So for me, if I'm sitting here, I've been paid, let's say, £100 from my employer, I've maybe paid 20% tax on that to take it down to 80 that I've got in my pocket. If I put that £80 into my pension, the government will top it up back up to 100. So I've got that immediate tax relief. It's tax relief at a rate of 20% because that's the rate of tax I've paid in the first place.
So immediately, if I'm a basic rate taxpayer, I'm getting a 20% uplift on my contribution straight away.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm paying £80 in. If that were into an ISA, that £80 would be invested. It would grow, do whatever it does. With a pension, you pay that £80 in and it immediately gets topped up by £20 to 100%, to £100, I should say. What that means is it's £100 being invested rather than just 80. It's got potential to grow on top of that as well. So you've got that immediate benefit.
Okay. So that's one of the tax benefits. Luke, I know you deal with some of our clients who are higher than 20% tax rate payers. How does that play out for them then? Is it just they just get 20%, do they?
If you're a higher rate or an additional rate, you'll get back the tax relief on the contribution that you paid in. So the way to think of it is, if you earn £100,000 a year and you put £10,000 into the pension, HMRC will assess you as earning £90,000 a year. So you're going to benefit from 40% tax relief in that instance. So a really valuable tool, especially for someone who earns over £100,000 a year. You're caught in the personal allowance tax trap, the 60% tax trap. where you're paying, you're losing the personal allowance and paying 40%. So it's a very valuable tool for a lot of clients to bring that income down and save on tax and get more money into the pension.
Okay. So it started to add up in my mind now. So you're getting 20% all added straight away. If you're higher rate, you're getting an extra 20. Doesn't get added onto investment. You get that back, don't you,
You claim that back from HMRC by self-assessment or using their live chat tool, yeah.
You can do, right,
you can do that now. But if you ask enough times, you can speak to a real person.
Right. And what happens then if you're lucky enough, in some respects, to be a 45% tax rate player?
Correct. Then you'll receive the further 20. You'll get the 20% initially. You'll then get the third of 25% back through HMRC self-assessment. So.
So when we say you get it back, you actually physically get the difference between 20 and 45 back.
Yeah, dissimilar to the 20%, which is paid straight into the pension, you'll get a cheque from HMRC with the money. Yeah.
I mean, it's almost too good to be true, isn't it? It's too good to be true that you can actually ostensibly get a 45% uplift on your investment in the first year. There's no investment I know of that's legitimate and not Bitcoin that would get you anything like that. So not absolutely. That Bitcoin will either, by the way.
No, I think to take the example I was given earlier where we placed £80 into the pension and an extra £20 was added, if you are an additional rate taxpayer paying the 45% rate of tax, you pay that £80 in, the £20 gets added to the pension, so you've got £100 getting invested. Then HMRC will come along and give you £25 back in your pocket. So realistically, you've got £100 in your pension. It's got the ability to grow. And it's only actually cost you £55 from your pocket because you've had that refund from HMRC.
That the concept of that all seems really simple. Certainly when it gets added at source to the 20%. And that's something, I presume, Hayley, we can do on impulse save again into our pension?
Absolutely. It's all done automatically. You can actually track your transaction history within the client site as well, so it will show you the difference of your contribution and also your tax relief going into the pot.
And then above that, though, for the higher rate taxpayers, it starts to get a little bit more complex. Maybe that's time that if you may be familiar investing in pensions, so it's not for you, you know how to do it. But if you don't, again, we're on hand to help you with any queries you may have. Yeah. And again, Hayley, 11:59 on the 5th of April?
Absolutely right.
Good. Now, that's one set of tax relief on a pension. So that's what happens when your money's in your pension fund. Is that the dividends getting taxed again or not?
No, very similar to the ISA that we talked about. Once the money's in the pension and let's say it grows in value, again, you're not paying capital gains tax on any growth. If it generates dividends for you, you're not paying tax on those. Everything that's within the pension is free to grow and continue to hopefully compound up over the years without any tax to pay.
Similar in an ISA, the same as an ISA in that sense.
Yeah, in the sense of the growth within the product, yes, there's no tax. Now, when it comes to taking money out, you've got to start talking about tax again, unfortunately, which differs slightly to the ISA, but I'm sure we can come on to that.
Okay. So that's two elements of tax relief straight away on a pension. You get the great benefit going in, you grow tax-free, and then coming out, Luke, what happens?
Yeah, so...
Do they take it all back again or not?
We've drawn down. The way it is taxed, for the most part, so with personal pensions, you've got 25% tax-free lump sum, which you don't have to take all at once. Historically, people did. But now you can take 5% tax-free. You can leave the rest invested and let that tax-free lump sum grow. It's very different in that that's all tax-free, but the 75% is taxed as income. But you can manage this with your financial advisor. If you're in retirement, you're in the accumulation stage, but you've got a personal allowance of £12,500, you could take income up to that £12,500 and then tax-free cash to remain a non-taxpayer and take what you need. So it is taxable for the most part, but you can manage it to manage the tax and hopefully not breach that 20% tax charge as a basic rate taxpayer.
That, again, is really interesting. So I'm going to spell it out for myself because I'm in that position. Tax relief going in, growing tax-free, and an element of tax-free cash to bring out at the end of it that you can take as a one-off hit, but you'd be advised not to because why would you do that? And certainly don't take it out and put it in cash because that would be the wrong thing to do, I think. But you can take that out. You can take it out in instalments, but you can also take it out to match your personal allowance every year as well.
Correct.
Okay. I'm suggesting here that when you get to that kind of level, unless you reasonably well understand pensions, you should be getting in touch with us to talk to one of you people about it.
Yeah, of course. A big part of the work we do is drawdown. It is quite a complex area in terms of tax, and obviously we want to make sure that you're taking the correct amount from your pension, not overpaying on tax and leaving the maximum amount invested in a secure and tax-efficient environment. So definitely get in touch with your advisor when you come to retirement and drawdown.
Hayley, how easy is it to get in touch with us as advisors? How easy? Because I presume first contact will be through your team.
Yep.
How easy is it to get to talk to Luke or John or one of their colleagues?
It's really straightforward. So every instance initially, you will come straight through to the relationship management team, if serviced by head office. So you will have multiple different avenues of communication. You've got the live chat feature, secure messaging, emails and phone calls. You come straight through to us and we will basically take all of the details that the particular advisor needs for whatever appointment is that you're looking for. We'll then pass all of the details over to the advisor and then you'll just be booked in for a video call or phone call, depending on what the preference is from that particular client.
Brilliant. So it's as easy as that. You can just make contact and we'll help you through it.
Take care of everything.
So we know an ISA. We've talked about that. Three really important tax reliefs on a pension. Mm-hmm. Is it use it or lose it? How does that play out, John?
So when it comes to an ISA, the £20,000 allowance that we talked about, that is very much use it or lose it. As soon as the 6th of April comes, any ISA allowance that I haven't used in the current tax year, that's gone. I've got a fresh allowance for next year. Now, with pensions, it's slightly different. The pension has what we call an annual allowance, which is the maximum amount that can go into your pension each tax year. That's for this year set at £60,000. So that's the total of your personal contributions, any tax relief that might have been added, and also any contributions that your employer might have made to your pension. All of that mustn't exceed £60,000 in a given tax year. Now, if you don't use that allowance, there is scope for carrying it forward, or if I'm sitting in this current tax year, I can carry it forward from previous tax years. So let's say I've been a member of a pension scheme for the last 3 years, but I've not actually paid anything in. My annual allowance for this year is £60,000. I've got three lots of £40,000 I could potentially carry forward from the past. Obviously a great benefit. Use it or lose it is obviously quite a difficult thing to contend with ISAs, but with pensions you've got a bit more flexibility to bring things forward. I think what's really important about pensions though as well is you've got your annual allowance of £60,000, but you've also got a kind of a sub-limit that sits below that, and that specifically applies to personal contributions. So if I'm sitting here, let's say I'm earning £30,000, I want to pay into my pension. I want to get tax relief on those contributions. Yes, I've got an annual allowance of £60,000, but as an individual, if I want to make personal contributions, I mustn't exceed the amount that I've actually earned in a tax year.
Okay.
HMRC aren't going to give you infinite tax relief. They're only going to give you your tax back on money that you've actually paid tax on. So for me, earning £30,000, I'm only going to get tax relief if I make a £30,000 gross contribution.
That makes sense to me. You've got a £60,000 allowance. You can bring it forward from previous years.
Yep.
But if you're not earning £60,000, you could maybe use some previous year's allowances to bring it forward. If you're lucky enough to have that money to invest, you've made an inheritance or whatever. It seems to me really common sense. If you've got cash lying around, you should get it under this tax shelter. The flexibility now of pensions, certainly be able to take money out, etc., means that to just leave it on cash seems like not the brightest thing to do in a sense like that. There's a lifetime allowance, though, isn't there, Luke? There's only so much you can put in over the course of your working life.
So the lifetime allowance is an interesting one, because it's something that I spent a lot of time learning about, and then the government took it away one of the last budgets. So it used to be 1.07 million, and this is the amount that you could have in a pension based on the old rules before paying a tax charge of 25% for income or 55% for lump sums. And they actually removed the lifetime allowance, and that's something that we'll have to keep an eye on with clients, because we know there's an election coming up. Labour have said that they could bring that back, and we don't know what way, shape or form that will be brought back. So they said they're going to bring it back in a bespoke way, so that's why it's important to have these conversations now and in the future. It's still around for the purposes of tax-free cash, so if you have over 1.07 million in a pension, the maximum tax-free cash you can draw, if you've got no protection, is 25% of that, so it's 268, 275. So it's still there. It means you can't draw more than that amount of tax-free cash. But the tax charges that were there are gone now. Really important that we keep an eye on that for the future, though, because we don't know what changes may come about with any government changes.
Right. We're getting into some areas there where we should expand on a little bit. I think we can't talk about people's individual taxation. They should talk to you, people. They should come through the method that Hayley said and start to talk to you. But the other interesting point is, We're probably going to get a general election. I think we definitely are before the next end of tax year. When you say they've taken it away, it means they've released the shackles, if you like. It's open-ended. You could put in over 1.07 0.07 million. Mm-hmm. But you've got to be careful and take advice on it. So this tax year seems like a great opportunity if you're able to have, if you're lucky enough to have the money and be in a position where your pension fund maybe at a size that was knocking into last year's lifetime allowance, to actually take some advice, because you could actually use this slight loophole this year to put a bit more in.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. I would say so. You can only advise on the rules at the time. Mm. I think pensions are obviously a massively beneficial tool. You've got the tax relief. I've talked about the fact that it's all tax-free growth. That's really important. There's nothing in the market like that other than the ISA, which has got the 20,000 limit. Another big thing is it's free of inheritance tax. So if you're a couple with married with children and you have a property worth $1 million, which a lot of people do now, especially down south, and that means you've got inheritance tax issues there. So, you know, any cash you've got, your properties, etc., that all adds up to part of that. And by putting that money away into a pension, that means that therefore it's free of inheritance tax. So that's a really important point there as well.
Okay. Inheritance tax is a really important point I missed on. And down south's an important point too, Luke, isn't it? Am I classed as being down south? Because I'm from Bradford.
You are from me, yeah.
Good lad, too. I think I am too. Really important point we made at the end there. Inheritance tax, and then let's link that into capital gains tax, I think, because that's another important tax when you get to the end of tax year and you've got to use your allowances. Tell me about the rules between husband and wife, civil partners, for inheritance tax. For capital gains tax. Is there something we should be bringing out for our clients on that?
Yeah, so husbands and wives or married couples, as a general rule, have advantages when it comes to their tax affairs. To start with, capital gains tax. As we mentioned before, capital gains tax is where you, say, buy an asset or an investment, it grows in value, and then you later sell it. So this often comes into play with things like those who have maybe more than one property. Their second property could be subject to capital gains tax if they've made a profit when they eventually sell it. The great thing with married couples is that you can transfer assets between one another. And when you move it, say, into my wife's name, she is treated as though she's owned that property from when I first bought it. So there's no immediate capital gains tax to pay for that transaction. Now, if I decided I was feeling generous and I gave you my second property, Steve, I've disposed of that. You're not my husband. I would have to pay capital gains tax on that transaction because I've disposed of the property and given it to you. Husbands and wives and married couples, they don't have that burden.
And capital gains tax rules or amounts changed at the last budget that we had a week or two ago? I can't remember, it was a while ago.
Yeah, absolutely. So capital gains tax, your standard rate for basic rate taxpayers is 10%. So whatever the asset has grown by, when you eventually sell it, you pay 10% capital gains tax. If you're a higher rate taxpayer, that's 20% capital gains tax. Under the old rules before the budget, if we were talking about a property, there's a what they call a surcharge, so it's a slightly higher rate. That was 28% for higher rate taxpayers or above. So if I sold a second property, made a capital gain, and I'm a higher rate taxpayer, it's 28% tax. The government have said they're going to nudge that down slightly. It's coming down to 24%. So a bit of saving there, but still a 24% tax on the growth.
And again, for clarity, that property is not your main residence. That's tax-free, capital gains tax-free, I believe.
Correct.
But beyond that, you're paying 24% soon.
Absolutely, yeah. Your main residence, the property that you live in, you're free to buy, sell, make a profit, upsize, downsize, whatever you want to do. You don't pay tax on that in terms of capital gains tax. But second properties that we're talking about, you potentially pay the 24% from April onwards.
We've covered quite a lot, haven't we? And I don't want to appear confusing to people, but let's just recap. We've covered three main product types today, including capital gains tax as a product, if you like, things that stop capital gains tax. ISAs are really useful because you're growing tax-free and you're taking out your proceeds tax-free. Pensions are really useful because you're putting money in and getting a tax benefit as soon as you go in. You're growing tax-free and you can take an element of it out tax-free as well. So really, really handy there. The other product is our advice, I think, that we need to make sure that people are aware that we're here. You ladies and gentlemen, are here to talk them through any problems and help them with any issues they've got. But we don't want to lose those tax allowances, so we've got to get things moving and get things in plan and sorted out before April the 5th, so 11:59 on the 5th of, yeah. 5th of April. I think we've covered quite a lot and we should probably stop there, but I think what I would say to everybody is please, If you are familiar with the products we've talked about and you're happy investing on your own account, then use Impulse Save or get in touch with one of Hayley and Hayley's team. If you need a little bit more advice, we've talked about how you can come through and get it. But certainly, please don't be inactive before the 5th of April because it's time to get it and we don't want to lose it. Yeah. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We normally finish off a little bit of what we're doing this weekend, but it's Easter, so I think we're all going to eat chocolate. I am, certainly. Yeah,
I've already started. I've been naughty. I've broken into the Easter eggs a little bit sooner than you should, so...
It's shocking, isn't it? Mm-hmm. For me, it's Nestles or Cadbury's, which is your favourite. Luke?
Probably Cadbury's.
It's got to be Cadbury's.
Mm. Yeah, I'm all for Cadbury's.
There you go. I'm probably just the same. We're just traditional at heart, aren't we? Thanks ever so much. If you've enjoyed watching, please give us a like. Look at it through your normal social media channel. But equally, if you've any queries whatsoever, get in touch with us and we'll be happy to help. Thanks very much.